Thank you for joining us today to discuss the St. David's Concussion Education, Prevention, and Management Program. Review of this program is required for parents and students participating in athletic activities at St. David's School. This requirement is noted in the athletic handbook. This video will also help you fully participate in your child's athletics and help ensure their health and safety, especially for contact sports. This program has been in effect for 4 years and now is internationally known. The program was developed by myself, a clinical neuropsychologist who works with a professional hockey team, other professional athletes, collegiate athletes, and athletes at all levels, and my wife, Dr. Lana Condor, a pediatric neuropsychologist who specializes with younger athletes. We developed the program where our children were still students at St. David's School and actively involved in the athletic program. In fact, our son Bobby played varsity football for 4 years. This slide is a photograph of an away game that was vigorous but clean and safe. And right in the middle there is our son Bobby. The St. David's Concussion Management Program is a comprehensive program which involves players, parents, coaches, athletic trainers, faculty, and healthcare professionals. The primary component of the program is education. Education for the players, coaches, athletic trainers, faculty, and staff. The education component includes safe playing on the field, injury prevention, and recognitions of signs and symptoms of concussion. Rationale for concussion evaluations include baseline testing when students are not injured, sideline testing for suspected concussion, post-injury testing, and return to play clearance. Physical and cognitive rest after concussion is essential. Many children are returned to play and to the classroom without any needed school accommodations. Let's start with a basic definition. Concussion is a traumatic brain injury caused by a direct or indirect impact to the head, which results in disruption of normal brain functioning. It may or may not result in the loss of consciousness. Thankfully, it is usually a transient phenomenon without any permanent neurologic damage. Current science suggests that this is a neurochemical process that alters brain chemistry without damage to the brain tissue itself. Usually the player returns to their pre-injury baseline in 7 to 10 days. However, there are complicated cases that have a more protracted recovery and need more intense evaluation and treatment. The St. David's School Concussion Education, Prevention, and Management Program is a comprehensive program for all involved. Concussion management and education is presented to the coaches. We have players' meetings at least twice a year for all contact sport athletes and any other athletes who wish to attend. There are parent meetings such as this. Due to the busy schedules of parents, we decided to make this a webinar format which will be accessible from your home anytime for your convenience. Concussion education is also presented to teachers and faculty. Parents and students have to read and sign an informed consent to play. The concussion management program is outlined in the school's athletic handbook, which requires parental signature. Here are some typical symptoms to watch for if you think your student has had a concussion after a game or activity. Please note that football and soccer are the greatest concussion generators, although lacrosse is not far behind. However, concussions can happen in any sport, as well as recreational activities in gyms and just the normal activities that kids do. Changes are noted in all dimensions of the student's behavior. This includes physical, grades, attitudes, and studying. There may be longer time for task completion, or the student may work harder for the same grades. Physically, headaches and fatigue are the most common symptoms. There may be difficulty with memory, difficulty with concentration, difficulty retaining newly learned material, and irritability. These symptoms are all different in nature and degree than what is seen in typical adolescents. Now we're going to watch a very good video on concussion diagnosis, management, and treatment. We have shown it for several years and have had excellent response from the students who watched the video. It was produced by the National Academy of Neuropsychology, our professional organization, and the National Athletic Trainers Association. We thank them for letting us show this educational video to you.
Hi, I'm Steve Young. If you play contact sports, you need to understand that there's a possibility you could get a concussion. Most athletes don't like to talk about concussions in a serious way, but the fact is, if you want to have a long playing career and live a healthy, productive life, you need to know the facts. When I started playing sports, everybody looked at concussions as a very minor injury. They were just dings. We even used to laugh at people who had a concussion because they would often stumble around with Bambi legs, or they did not know what was happening in the game. Now we know it's not a laughing matter. Concussions are serious business. We need to pay attention to the risks and consequences of these invisible injuries. I've asked some of my friends, leading concussion experts, and a few athletes you may recognize to give you a crash course in concussions. Pay attention. No matter which sport you play, this information may save your career or even your life.
Concussion comes from the Latin word concussus, and that means violently shake. So basically, that's what a concussion is. The brain is quite violently shaken inside the skull.
I think the one thing you have to understand about concussions is that size doesn't matter. It doesn't matter if you're the biggest 6'6", 300-pound lineman, or if you're that small flanker that's running wide receiver and working the reverses. Everybody is possible for concussions. It's not dictated by your size. And that's the thing about brain injuries and understanding concussions, is they don't discriminate. It's how you're hit, how you're affected.
If in doubt, sit them out.
Signs and symptoms of concussion are really varied, and it's important to recognize that not only are they varied, but they can change over time. Typically what happens is a player will feel stunned, somewhat confused, a bit disoriented. They may see some stars, they may develop a headache, they may develop nausea. When they come off to the sideline, they may describe that the lights are too bright, they have light sensitivity, they have difficulty with sound, loud noises can bother them. Sometimes players have significant difficulties with balance.
You know, suddenly someone said, well, what happened 5 minutes ago? You're like, I can't remember what happened 5 minutes ago. So there's kind of this fuzzy feeling, and you knew that you weren't all there.
What people have to understand is anytime you have an altered state of mind, anytime you take a hit, you feel dinged, you feel like you're a little confused, maybe your vision's cloudy, there's some dizziness that goes on. When dealing with the symptoms of a concussion, you have to understand not only are you going to feel some things right away, but you may feel some things for a couple days. You may have symptoms that last for a couple days, or potentially you may not have any problems, and then a couple days down the road, you suddenly have a headache, you suddenly have problems with motion sickness. Anytime you have symptoms like that, you've suffered a concussion and you need to seek medical attention right away.
The best marker of the severity of a concussion is not exclusively how many symptoms or how severe they are, but mostly how long they last, although all three are important.
If you're in doubt, sit it out.
In summary, concussion symptoms are varied and can be grouped into four categories. Physical symptoms, including headache, dizziness, and nausea. Cognitive symptoms, including problems with memory, attention, and feeling slowed down. Emotional symptoms, such as sadness, irritability, and feeling nervous. And finally, problems with sleeping.
As players, you always feel like you can play. You know, my dad always taught me, if you can walk, you can play. If you're not bleeding, then you're not hurt. So, you know, you try to play through those things. With a concussion, being foggy and being in that state, you probably do feel like you can go back out on the field. So I think it's really up to the medical staff to diagnose you, to run you through the test, to give you the proper time to sit out in order to know whether or not you can go back on the field.
If you don't fix the injury, now you're going to get those syndromes that you hear about, where you're constantly hitting your brain and it doesn't give a chance to recover.
When in doubt, sit out.
I think with concussion, there are age differences. I think we're concerned that our young athletes may recover more slowly than our adult athletes from the same concussion. And we're also concerned that young athletes may be more easily concussed than adult athletes. So on both scores, we're a bit more conservative with our young athletes than we are perhaps with an adult.
You need to be smart, you need to be honest, you need to tell someone.
You have to communicate with your parents, you have to communicate with your athletic trainers, and you have to communicate with your coaches.
Athletes inherently want to play, and I think they oftentimes will minimize their symptoms.
You know, yeah, sometimes you do get dehydrated and you may feel disoriented, but if you receive the hit to the head and you feel that type of pounding, you know, it's not up to you to be Superman. It's not up to you to be the hero of the team. You know, you gotta think about your health, think about your safety, think about your life. And so you definitely should be checked out if you're feeling these symptoms.
If in doubt, set them out. If a player is symptomatic, they should not be playing at all. That player should be sat until that player is symptom-free, both at rest and when we physically exert them.
One of the things that's important is rest. So not only physical rest, but also mental rest. And I think we sometimes minimize, you know, what a kid will oftentimes go home and watch TV or start using the computer, and things like that are considered taxing. So you want to try to avoid some of those things. It's also important to avoid alcohol, avoid other types of medications or drugs that would affect your brain.
If in doubt, sit them out.
I'm confident that if you have a concussion and you get the proper medical attention and you let your injury heal correctly, you should be able to go back and play football. It's just like any other injury, but it needs to be diagnosed and it needs to be healed.
I think is important. Being able to look in their eyes and just get a sense that they're dazed, they're confused, they're having difficulty. When you ask them questions, they're slow to respond. You can tell that it's just taking them a little bit of time for them to answer your questions.
You want to try to ask simple questions. What's the score of the game? Who did we play last week? What did you have for breakfast? A coach that's unsure as to whether or not a concussion has occurred should always err on the side of caution. Remove that athlete from participation until they can be absolutely certain that he or she is ready to return to play.
It's not a game. It's not a joke. If you're dizzy, if you have an extreme headache, if it feels like you can't remember what the last call was in the huddle, if you're getting the call in the huddle, you're having to walk out and ask somebody else, you know, these are things you need to talk about with your training staff and with your medical staff.
We know that when a player has a brain injury, that they tend to have difficulties with memory, particularly short-term memory. They have difficulty with how quickly they process information, how well they can think through problems, how well they can analyze problems, and how they put those all together. We know that those different aspects of brain functioning are affected in concussion. So as neuropsychologists, people who study brain-behavior relationships, we're able to assess or take a look at how the brain is functioning by looking at these various ways that the brain functions.
And so oftentimes the benefit of neurocognitive testing is that it just gives you a little more, you know, one more piece of the puzzle, one more tool in your toolbox.
I think it's important to understand that if your team has the ability to do neurocognitive testing, when you start off the season and they ask you to do a baseline test, you need to take it very seriously, because after having a concussion or what appears to be a concussion, they can give you these tests, these neurocognitive tests, that will show them how much your reaction time, how much your memory has changed based on that baseline test.
In a typical concussion management program, there is an initial preseason baseline evaluation that may contain neuropsychological, balance, and other testing. After an injury occurs, the athlete is evaluated on the sideline or in the locker room for signs and symptoms of concussion using a neurological exam and other sideline evaluation tools. If a concussion is diagnosed, the player is kept out of play and not returned in the same game. Once all symptoms have cleared, at rest and when physically exerted, the player is again evaluated with neurological, neuropsychological, balance, and other testing as needed. The test results are then compared to the baseline tests in order to help determine whether the athlete is ready to return to play.
It's one thing as a football player, we're always brought up and trained to be macho and work through an injury. If you're a little hot, keep running. If you sprained an ankle, just tape it up and keep going. If your shoulder hurts a little bit, throw a pad on and keep going. It's completely different when you're dealing with the brain and when you're dealing with head trauma and concussions. You have to understand there is a course of treatment and a course of rest that you need before you return to the field.
People will be like, oh, I can go play. Now you're taking the time to get evaluated. You're talking to the doctor. You're taking all the tests necessary to ensure your safety and your health.
So you have to educate the coaching staff that it's not okay to play with a headache or that it's not okay to play if someone's had a concussion.
So play tough, play smart. Not always easy to do. The tough part's easy, the smart part not as easy. We challenge you to do both.
And if you're in doubt, really need to sit them out.
Players should report all symptoms to medical staff promptly. If a player is suspected of having a concussion, the player should be removed from the game or practice and should not return to play on the same day. Players diagnosed with concussion should not return to play unless they have a written clearance from a healthcare professional that is trained in the evaluation and management of concussion.
So there you have it, a crash course in concussion. Keep in mind that if these injuries aren't managed and identified, the symptoms can last longer than you might expect. And while rare, a concussion you get now could have long-term lasting effects that can be with you for the rest of your life. Chances are that you will have a concussion if you play long enough. Now you know the signs and symptoms, who to turn to for help, what to expect, and when it's safe to return to play. Remember, if in doubt, sit it out. Injury is a risk in any sport, but today we know more than ever before. Let's use the science to our benefit. Take what you've learned today and remember it. In the end, it will help you have fun, play safe, and stay in the game.
Hey, wasn't that a great video, especially for your students? You may notice that Dr. Guskowitz and Dr. Cantu are on the faculty at UNC Chapel Hill. Returning to our program, a primary aspect is prevention. Prevention can be accomplished by many factors. One is education, such as what we are doing now, and educational meetings with coaches and players. We're always looking out for the best equipment. Please note that there is no equipment that prevents concussion. There is some equipment that may reduce the physical impact of concussion. We always look at the most rigorous scientific studies for equipment. Please note that modifications to equipment will invalidate the NOCSI standards and actually may make the equipment more dangerous for the players. As teenagers tend to listen to peers more than parents and coaches, we urge them not to try to hide symptoms, but to have their peers encourage them to talk to their coaches. There is some evidence that players who have better cardiovascular and muscular strength may be less affected by concussive forces and may recover quicker. There is some thinking that strengthening neck muscles may also help. Additionally, the best practices include activities during practice and games, such as keeping your head up when blocking or tackling. Tackle only when you can see the number on the other player's jersey, no head-to-head hits, and no spear tackling. Proper management after a concussion is essential for a good, timely recovery. We provide baseline neurocognitive testing for all students when they are not injured. Make sure your child participates in this baseline testing and takes it seriously, giving good effort. Post-injury testing lets us know the degree of their injury and helps guide treatment. There is sideline assessment during the game for students with suspected concussion. If your student has a concussion, you will be given a handout with information about the concussion clinics with medical and healthcare professionals who have training in concussion management and will evaluate your student and provide needed medical care. If there is a serious injury on the field, EMTs will be called. Fortunately, this is a very rare occurrence. Cognitive and physical rest are the most common treatment for concussion. There also will be post-injury reassessment to compare with baseline performance. This includes not only repeated computer testing, but more sensitive pencil and paper tasks, which will identify likely problems to arise in the classroom. Some students may have longer recovery requiring school accommodations on a time-limited basis. Readiness to return to play will be the last assessment undertaken. Caution is urged not to rush return to play, since concussed students are more susceptible to repeated concussive forces and new injuries may require longer recovery time. When needed, we have been successful at St. David's School in introducing specific school accommodations for students. These include a modified day, a shorter school day, modified work such as no test or no homework, classroom support and provision of teachers' outlines and class notes to reduce writing requirements. Honors and AP students are given special consideration as these students may be reluctant to access accommodations or to comply with cognitive rest for good recovery. These students may need a letter on file with their college admissions office to reduce anxiety about how their injury will look to colleges. Finally, there are wonderful resources available on the internet. The CDC toolkit from the Center for Disease Control and Recovery has another video as well as handouts and other information for coaches, doctors, and players. The Gefeller Center at UNC Chapel Hill also has great information available. You have just watched our National Academy of Neuropsychology football video, which you can download for free at this website, as well as a hockey video. Finally, our Sports Neuropsychology Society's website lists qualified professionals who can assess students with concussion and help manage their recovery. Overall, remember the slogan, when in doubt, sit them out. In closing, I wish to thank Mr. Joe Knott, Chairman of the St. David School Board, for his strong support of this program, and Mr. Kevin Lockerbie, Head of School, for his support. Thank you very much for viewing our presentation. Please let us know if you have any questions at all about this program. Please direct your questions to the athletic staff at St. David School. Thank you.